Welcome back everyone to the lecture about applied bioimage analysis. This week will be about advanced image schema co-programming, and we start with regions of interest, ROIs and overlays. But before we really dive deeply into the topic, I wanted to mention, I forgot it actually last week, there is a nice website from the image schema makers, from the image schema macro makers. Rain Vesperen, for example, is maintaining this website, where you find on the one hand an introduction to the ImageJ macro language with some short examples similar to those I show you here in the lecture, and a full list of all commands you can call from the macro language. Furthermore, during the exercise last week, some of you were struggling with the fact that when you call the particle analyzer and you ask it to summarize your measurements, so if you tick the summarize checkbox, the roundness and the aspect ratio are not summarized, so there is no mean aspect ratio or mean roundness in the results in the summary table. And as I also wasn't sure if this is intentional or if this is a bug, I asked in the ImageSC forum, so I posted a little piece of code, so a minimal reproducing example, so a little piece of code which shows the issue I had, with some screenshots below explaining what my problem is, hoping that some other expert could help me here. And I got an answer from Image Jan. So Image Jan is Jan Eklinger, a bioimage analyst from Basel. I would call him a friend. He from time to time answers my questions. Very kind. Thank you, Jan. And he was mentioning that, yes, that's a problem. He's actually pointing us to the source code where the problem may be. And furthermore, he is pointing us to a workaround. So you can, instead of using the summarize checkbox in the particle analyzer, you can get the normal results table and then summarize it yourself. And with that, you get four additional lines in your results table, which calculate the mean, the standard deviation, the minimum, and the maximum. And in that way, you can actually get the mean roundness and the mean aspect ratio. But furthermore, he is also pointing us to the fact that the mean value of these shape descriptors may not be very meaningful, or it's hard to say if they are a good measurement. So it's like for him an expert and for me an expert, it's hard to judge if the mean circularity, the mean roundness actually makes sense from a further data analysis point of view. And that brings us to an interesting question. A workflow we programmed last week. We start from this image and we do a shape measurement. For example, we plot the circularity over time. Is this workflow actually repeatable? I mean, let's go through these five properties of scientific experiments of data analysis workflows. I would like to discuss with you in the lecture hall now, but unfortunately that's not possible. So is it repeatable? Can we do this experiment again? Yeah, sure. We can just execute the script again and it will turn out that the results are the same and the data is not damaged or harmed. So we can repeat this experiment as often as we want. Is it reproducible? The question with the reproducibility is a bit harder to answer because we are not sure if we would now ask somebody else to run this script on his or her data, if the result would be the same. So I would be optimistic that this script also works on different data, but we haven't proven it yet. We haven't tried it out. So that's why we cannot for sure say if this is a reproducible experiment. Is it quantitative? Yeah, we derive a numeric measurement from our data. So I would definitely say it's quantitative. Is it objective? Also, half, it's semi-objective because it's still a person who programmed this particular workflow and changed the workflow until he or she was happy with the results. So it is still a little bit subjective, I would say. And the most important question is it reliable? So when you look here at this video and you look at the plot over time, you cannot associate the video, what we observe here, with the plot. So that's why we cannot say if the plot is actually related to our image, to our measurement in the image, or if the number of roundish cells, which increases over time, I agree, but if it's really a good measurement or if it's really related to each other, we cannot judge. So that's why I would rather say that it's not reliable. I don't trust this workflow yet, because we have to do additional steps in order to achieve that. And one potential step towards that is simply visualization. So super important in image analysis is if you program a workflow which analyzes data, find a good way to visualize the results in a way that the user can gain trust into the workflow. that one can actually see visually, not just by numbers, that the measurements make sense and that it's a reliable measurement. A program which takes a bunch of images and produces a table is, from my point of view, per definition, not trustworthy, because it should, in whatever way, produce additionally a bunch of images showing what is actually measured, what is counted in it in this result table. So that's why visualization of results or visualization of intermediate results is very, very important in bioimage analysis. So that's a slide I showed earlier. So that's the suggested workflow. So we go from the original image, we do some thresholding, we do particle analysis, and then we do an export to the ROI manager, and from that we get a table by doing measurements. And we can actually use the same strategy as we have the ROIs here in our ROI manager. We can use the same strategy to also visualize the ROI. So instead of just putting something in the results table, we will also visualize ROIs. And therefore, you may have done some of these operations already. It's good to know that every button or every menu you have in the ROI manager is actually programmable. So you see that when you record, you use the recorder while using the ROI manager. And you can also, of course, type that yourself or use auto-completion in order to get these commands. And this list is also on cheat sheet, by the way. So if you, for example, later on in an exercise potentially, want to visualize a particular ROI from the ROI manager, you use this select method in order to click in this list. So if I would click here, the recorder would record that I clicked on item number 2, because the first one is number 0, the second one is number 1, and the third one is number 2. So let's assume we just selected an ROI in the ROI manager, and we now want to make it a yellow rectangle. So we can call the ROI set fill column method in order to make it look like this. And the three numbers here behind is the red, the green, and the blue channel. So a large number between 0 and 255. Red and green are yellow together, right? And there's not much blue. That's why, obviously, that's a yellow rectangle. But furthermore, we can also change the stroke color of our eyes. So in order to make it a green outline, what we can unfortunately not do with one particular ROI. And we cannot set the fill color and the stroke color, so it will always just do one of both. Either an outline with a different column, or it's filled with a certain color. Both at the same time is unfortunately not possible. Furthermore, we can also put text in images, for example, a measurement or a description of an object, a name of an object in an image. If we want to have all our eyes in one image, we have to put them into the so-called overlay. So as you have seen earlier, when you outline something by hand in ImageJ, then you outline something else, it's the first one is gone. And the same happens if you programmatically add ROIs to an image. That's why if you want to collect several things for visualization purposes in one image, you have to put them into the overlay. You have to add the selection to the overlay. And furthermore, if you want to finally put the overlay into the actual image, I show you in a second how this is done. You have to call the so-called flatten method, which reduces an image with an overlay to an image. And the important point here is that this is no longer an 8-bit image. And it also means that it overrides pixel values. Okay, let's try that out. So I start with a new script, and I start with a new image. So for example, 100 times 100 pixels. And I basically repeat what we did in the first exercise. I draw a circle. I add it to the ROI manager. I draw another circle. I add it to the ROI manager. Maybe I add a third one. And now I will add from the script colors to these ROIs. So let's assume that the list of ROIs in the ROI manager, I can go through here, is a result of the particle analyzer. So this is what the particle analyzer gave us. It gave us ROIs in the ROI manager. And if you now want to put specific colors on these ROIs, for example, to visualize their properties, we first of all have to select something in the ROI manager. We can get this by selecting the right language. and starting to type ROI manager, right? And you find here all the things you can do with an ROI manager. And there is, for example, one entry which is called select. And you can also read here that it selects. And there's also an example code linked and stuff, so it's really like as convenient as possible. And when you hit enter, you have the command there, and you can then, for example, say, okay, I select ROI number one, and I make it green with the set stroke color command. And I just enter green, right? Let's see. When I execute this program, the first entry, number zero, is selected in the ROI manager and it's made green. Now I will make the second one. Second one, index one, and I will make it yellow. And here we now only see the second one. Because you can, in this coding way, when you would change properties of ROIs and you want to select them individually and do something with them, you can only select them individually. So you cannot have them all visible at a time. This is what the overlay is for. So we have to add it to the overlay. And the command for this is overlay. And you see, I just go through this pull down here and it has a command called add selection. So I can add the current selection to the overlay. It means also by the end of my program, it also makes sense. I can also call the command select none. This one that actually originates from the menu edit selection select none. So it's as if I would select nothing in the original image. And when I execute this one, I see both ROIs in my image. And if I now zoom in here, you see that this is a super, super, super thin line. So when I move with my mouse here and I look at the main window over there, what pixel intensity is there? It's all zero. So it's still a black image where all pixels are zero. There's never any pixel which has a different value from zero. However, if I want to if I want to save this image in a way that also other programs can open it and can show the outlines for visualization, to show it in PowerPoint, for example, right? I have to flatten this image. The command for flattening is this one, or actually this one. Does they do the same, I believe. And if I execute this one, I get another window where then obviously the pixels are changed. Yeah. So it's also, this was an 8-bit image. This is now an RGB image. And when I move in here, you see that the value in the main window highlighted changed. And it's also, it's three values, right? It's the red, the green, and the blue. That's what RGB here says. Yeah, and this is an image you could save to disk, and you can open in PowerPoint or in any other program where the outlines are actually visible. Yeah, but this is kind of important if you want to visualize some different things in different colors. So this is this part. The next part will be about functions, arrays, plots, and tables. See you in a minute.